And joining me now is Melissa Mark-Viverito, former Speaker of the New York City Council and City Council member for the 8th District. She is now running for New York City Public Advocate, and you're running on the ballot line of Fix the MTA,
yes,
which we'll get into in a minute. But before we get to the Public Advocate campaign, as City Council Speaker, as a City Council member, maybe just share with viewers what you think are some of your top accomplishments, your record, your resume.
Well, look, I tell people, you know, voters, that I am an agent for change, right? I've been someone who has, in her heart, believes in equity and justice for everyone, raised by my mother as a feminist and an activist in Puerto Rico. That is the framework that I was raised in, right? Fighting for equity and for justice and utilizing and leveraging the power and the influence of having been an elected city council member, of having been the speaker, to figure out, right, how we can promote initiatives, legislation, policy ideas that reach that goal of creating more equity, more justice for all New Yorkers. And so I'm very proud of that track record as a council member and a speaker, where I fought for criminal justice reform. All right, when we talk about closing Rikers Island, I really took the lead on that, got pushback from the administration. I went against the mayor. I said it had to be done. When we talked about low-level, nonviolent offenses, decriminalizing those, right? And Bratton said that the city was going to become a hellscape again, and we are continue to be the biggest city when we've seen an incredible reduction in those offenses in terms of arrests or summonses for those arrests. So, you know, it's about really looking at opportunities to bring greater justice and equity to New Yorkers. And I'm really excited about this race to be able to make that case, that because of my negotiating skills and what I fought for and my consistency and my successes, that I am best suited, right, to be in this position and be able to utilize the bully pulpit, the platform, the introduction of legislation, the oversight, independent oversight of the mayor and city agencies to really effectuate change. And that's what this is about.
Right. So you just talked a little bit about what the role of public advocate
yes.
is. So what is essential in being public advocate as you see it when you decided you're out of the city council, you're on to some other things, this vacancy pops open? Why you? Why did you say this is a job that I want? What's so essential about being public advocate that you need to fill that
well,
void?
I mean, look, public service is an incredibly humbling opportunity, right? I think it is about serving the people and making government really effective in the way that it does that, right? Being nimble, effective. You know, we have changing constituencies in the city of New York. We are a dynamic city. And so we got to make sure that the agencies that are serving constituents and New Yorkers are really meeting that need, right? Are really being flexible and being effective in the way that they provide services to all New Yorkers geographically, racially, ethnically, et cetera, language-wise. So, you know, that's important. And also being an independent watchdog, right? I give the example these days that the mayor has talked about this health care for all kind of concept here in the city of New York. There's a promise that now has been made to New Yorkers. And we got to ensure that that promise is kept. How is that going to be rolled out? How are conversations going to happen? How are we going to make sure New Yorkers know that this is available to them? How do they avail themselves to this? So there's a real need to make sure that we hold ourselves accountable and we hold government accountable to the promises that it's made to New Yorkers. So I think, you know, the role of public advocate is about that independent watchdog, again, looking at city agencies and how they are providing services. It is about putting forth legislation. It is also about using the bully pulpit, right? Your citywide platform, an ability to raise your voice, to amplify the dissatisfaction that New Yorkers have with the MTA and the subways,
right? So let's
right?
talk about that. That's,
right.
That's your ballot line. People can't run on Democrat or Republican. You're a Democrat, of course, so you have to create your own ballot
yes.
line. Yours is Fix the MTA, certainly something that sounds appealing to a lot of New Yorkers. But as you say, as public advocate, that might fall into that last bucket of the bully pulpit, right? You can't really legislate or do much on the MTA, but raise your voice. So what would that look like?
I mean, I think there's a couple of things, right? There are recommendations and policy ideas that I've put forth. One, I've always been a supporter of congestion pricing back into 2008 when I was a big supporter in the city council. We have seen the state legislature not take any action on this issue. And that is obviously something that has to pass because we have some revenue needs that the MTA has, right? There is a plan in place, a 10-year plan, that has been put forward by Andy Byford, which, if fulfilled, would basically bring all of the stations up to date, ADA compliant, et cetera. But there's a gap there in terms of revenue. It needs revenue. Congestion pricing has to pass. We need to do that. Also, the issue of legalization of marijuana, which I support. I've always supported. But the idea that as we set up a framework in the state of New York of how to do that, there are going to be licensing fees, there are going to be taxes in the sales, et cetera. So there's revenue that is potential there. I've talked about the weed for rails concept and about utilizing a portion of that towards the infrastructure needs of the city of New York, and the remainder, obviously, to make communities that have been disproportionately impacted by the war on drugs, I create opportunities for training, for being an entrepreneur, owning your own business, whatever opportunities can emerge out of that. That's a very tangible proposal, which others are not talking about, right? So the idea of just building a coalition, raising visibility, telling the governor he's got to take the lead on this. He wants to keep shucking it and saying it's not his responsibility, the MTA. So it's about really bringing a coalition that is going to focus on this and keep beating that drum to make it a priority.
And so you talked a little bit about the mayor, the governor, navigating that. As public advocate, do you see yourself as someone who needs to be out there holding press conferences and really calling out people who are not doing what they need to do, or more behind the scenes trying to build those coalitions? How do you balance that? I know as city council speaker, you obviously had to face those challenges. So sort of shed a little light on your approach.
I think it's all of that, right? There is the issue of raising visibility, making it something that's very, you know, frontal attack, so to speak. Like this always constant, you know, I ride the subways every day and I'm, you know, frustrated as everybody else with the delays. The impact it has on the quality of life of New Yorkers who every day are stressed about whether or not they're going to be late to work, if they're stressed if their child is going to get to school on time, if they're going to be able to pick up their child after school. The impact that it has on the quality of life of New Yorkers, and for low-income New Yorkers, who this is their primary source of transportation and have limited options, they can't be calling the Lyft every day or Uber or whatever it may be. You know, this is why, to me, it's a crisis that is going unaddressed. So
that's
the idea
of
very vocal and very visible and, you know, telling the stories of New Yorkers. And we all know the trains are broken, right? And the system is broken and crumbling around us. Where is the leadership to say we're going to make sure that we find the revenue needed to fund the plan that has been presented, while at the same time looking at whatever mismanagement may be, right? There's always the need to streamline and to figure out ways if we can save money, but obviously not compromising the quality of the services.
So the MTA is obviously a big one, but also the city has been facing a real crisis around NYCHA.
Yes.
And both of those issues are things that are longstanding, that have really been percolating, but really come to a boiling point over the last, let's say, two or so years.
NYCHA, no. I would say more so with the MTA. With NYCHA, I've been consistently, right, from the day I walked in the door, because I do live and I represented the district with the most public housing. This is something that I have fought for consistently. And I tell people that we've seen incredible change and shift in prioritizing NYCHA in a way that it hadn't been before.
I'm referring more to the lead scandal, right, and things like that.
Of course.
Absolutely, your point well taken, certainly. And the mayor, this is something where people, I think, need to give him a sort of a mixed grade on that, because he did put more resources towards NYCHA, but also has had some major failings on the issue.
On both issues, the city and state have to step up. On both issues, the state has a role to play as well, right? Because NYCHA, in essence, is a state-authorized entity. And so there is a role in oversight. There is a role in changing rules and reporting structures that we can't do as a city council. We're very limited in what we were able to actually do when it came to oversight of NYCHA. That is more something that the state has responsibility for, but also the investing of monies, of consistent investing in capital needs of NYCHA, because the federal government has disinvested from public housing. And we've seen other authorities in other states and other cities, right, that have completely demolished public housing. We don't want to see that happen here. We have to safeguard public housing and improve the quality of life of the residents that live there.
On things like the lead issue, the heat and hot water issues that we've seen, and also even on the MTA, was there enough urgency while you were speaker in the mayor's first term? You were working together on a lot of initiatives. Was there enough of a sense of these two major institutions are sort of descending into more crisis and chaos? Did you have your finger on that
pulse? So there's two things. On the MTA, despite the fact that it is a state authority and we are, again, our city are limited, there was this push, right, of wanting the city to pay towards some of the capital needs and the revenue needs of MTA. We held several hearings, even though it's something that we can't legislate on, something that we have limited. But if they wanted money from the city of New York, then we wanted them to come to us and be able to explain what their thought process was. So I took the leadership in terms of having a series of hearings on the MTA, regardless of whether or not we had direct oversight. And then the issue of NYCHA, the same, right? NYCHA was a subcommittee when I became speaker. I made it a full committee because of the urgency and because I wanted to really have it be something that had more standing and the ability to really call NYCHA in and do hearings more aggressively, et cetera. We did many hearings on many issues, the broken elevators, shedding light, you know, transparency on issues there, on lead. We did, I think it was one or two hearings because that was when it was starting to come out. And we've done many, many hearings.
You had no sense at the time that these inspections had lapsed or that the paperwork had been falsified.
That stuff was emerging, yes. And some through the hearings that we held, that was under Richie Torres. It's obviously under different leadership now. But we did a series of hearings on that. And the issue also of where are the monies that are being invested, because those of us in the city council with the discretionary allocations that we had, we were putting millions of dollars into NYCHA for capital improvements, you know, asking about where those improvements were, how was contracting happening, et cetera. There was a lot of series of oversight hearings on NYCHA and bringing a lot of attention to it, a lot of scrutiny, raising awareness of the challenges, making sure that we were getting more funding for NYCHA. And we saw an incredible increase over the years that I was in the city council. By the time I left, you know, we had a commitment from the mayor of close to $20 billion over 10 years, where when Bloomberg was in office, when I first came in, there was absolutely almost no investment in NYCHA from the city. So there's been a vast change in approach about how we look at NYCHA.
Could talk about NYCHA for a lot longer, but no, and I have other questions, but and we have a few more minutes. You have made your campaign centered around one issue, which is the need for better diversity in city leadership,
yes,
especially when it comes to gender. Explain that a little bit more. Is that the reason for people to vote for you? How do you sort of capture that to voters? Because we do have a white male mayor, comptroller, city council speaker at this point. So how do you sort of argue that?
I think it's important to put focus on it. And that's what I've been doing, because a lot of times people first don't know there's a special election. Two, really don't know the dynamics of the city. So when you start shedding light on it and explaining it, people are alarmed, right? When I talk about the fact that when I came into the council, there were 18 women out of 51 members. We're now at 11 out of 51. When now that Tish James has become our attorney general in that historic, you know, appointment, election, that we now have no women in citywide office, it alarms people, right? So it's shedding light on it. And I tell people, look, I'm the most qualified by far in this field based on my experience and my success and my track record. But I also don't want it to be lost that when we talk about being a progressive city, when we talk ourselves as being progressives, if we are not fighting for a representative government, then we're not truly progressive, because our viewpoints and experiences that are being left out when we're making policy decisions, when we're negotiating budgets, if we don't have the voice of women and our experiences in the workplace, our experiences as, you know, with raising our families, and those experiences are not at the table. So I tell people, it's no coincidence, right, that it's Jalissa Ferreras-Copeland, chairing finance, and myself that took the lead on making sure we passed legislation to ensure we had feminine hygiene products in our public schools for our young women. It's no coincidence when the mayor and the commissioner talk about New York City being the safest city, which we are, and we should be proud of that, that they don't talk about the 29% increase in reporting around rapes, right? And, oh, you know, there's that conversation, well, women are feeling more comfortable reporting. You still should be talking about it. You should still try to be providing me as a woman assurances, right, that we're doing everything as a city to ensure, right, that we minimize violence and gender-based violence and that we're creating a safe city. You have to speak to us in that way. And that those are perspectives that are lost because our view and our point of view is not at the decision-making table. So I think that that's something to raise awareness about. And again, as I said, we are not a progressive city if we're not taking into account that our government has to be representative, not just racially, not just ethnically, but also with regards to gender. And that is one of the reasons that I also considered running, because I knew when Tish announced that there was going to be that gap in representation, and I felt that it was important for a viable, strong woman candidate to run. And after conversations, you know, I decided to do it.
This position obviously is all about being a watchdog over the city, the mayoral agencies. Should people be concerned that you're too close with Mayor de Blasio? Should people be assured that you have no hesitation to call him out when it is needed?
I have absolutely, I mean, I gave experiences before about issues that I've taken
Rikers.
On, right?
Mm-hmm.
Rikers, the decriminalization of low-level nonviolent offenses, the legal fund for those facing deportation that the mayor really didn't want to put money towards. These are all things that, because I believed in, you know, I pushed it back. So I have been independent. Now, the reality is, though, the role of speaker is very different from the role of public advocate. And I'm very clear about that distinction. And being a speaker is about leading a legislative body of 50 other members and trying to build consensus and negotiating. It's not about being my city council. It was our city council. And so I had to be able to bring people together and have conversations and negotiate, right? So that's a very different role than being an independent, you know, person in terms of public advocate, that's whose role is a direct relationship with constituents, being a voice of the constituents of New York, and being a watchdog to make sure city agencies and city services are serving them in the best way possible. And that also means holding the mayor accountable when he makes promises, right? Closing Rikers, supposedly he supports it, supposedly we're moving as a city towards that. I don't see much progress. I'm concerned about the lack of community engagement. I've been saying that publicly. I will definitely be much more vocal now once I'm back in elected office on those issues, and I have a track record of that.
And so in our last 10 seconds here, asking a lot of the public advocate candidates, running for mayor in 2021 is something that you have not ruled out, correct?
I don't know what I'm going to do. I'm being very honest with people. I'm an honest, transparent person. I'm not going to say something because people want to, you know, what people want to hear that I say, or people trying to force me into a corner to say something that they want me to say. I'm very honest with people. I say, I don't know what I'm going to do. You know, I may decide not to run at all. February 26th, that same day, we start gathering petitions already for the primary in June. There's a lot of work ahead of me most immediately. I'm very focused on this. Running a citywide campaign in 3 months is not an easy thing, creating an infrastructure, raising the money, everything. So I'm very focused, and I just don't know what I will be doing. And that's a genuine, honest answer.
Okay. Well, we'll leave it there.
Thank
Melissa
Mark-Viverito,
thank you.
Thank
Appreciate
you.
It.